The basic tools of information technology we use to communicate have become a nightmare for some. The need to create a cybercrime division was felt by Pakistan when Daniel Pearl was kidnapped back in 2002, and his captor started sending anonymous emails to newspapers, prompting authorities in Pakistan to seek external help to pinpoint the senders.
FIA was asked to create a new department. So that was done, and a new department with the name of NR3C, National Response Center for Cybercrime, was created.
Pakistan launched its National Response Center for Cybercrime to combat criminals of the digital world. But complicated issues require calculated measures. Introducing cybercrime offense punishable by death or life imprisonment in case terrorists commit e-crime resulting in loss of life is meant to deter the would-be e-offenders.
It's only pertaining to one section, that is cyber terrorism. And even in that section, it makes very clear that death penalty will be given in all those cases in which some human death has occurred.
But there is confusion over the policy.
That is really something I can't understand it for two reasons. First is a policy reason. On one hand, the government is saying that they are actually going to convert the death penalty into commutement, to convert them into life imprisonment. But on the other hand, they are providing a death penalty for the cyber crimes.
Under the umbrella of the Federal Investigation Agency, the cybercrime wing has total power over policing the internet and other modes of information technology in Pakistan.
We just not register a case immediately. We carry out an inquiry. And during inquiry, we find out that whether the person is found guilty of this particular crime or not. If he is found guilty based on the evidence, only then a proper case is registered and the person is prosecuted.
The 30-point e-bill passed by Parliament last year, which includes malicious code, cyber terrorism, hacking for ransom, spamming, and spoofing, seems to cover all aspects of the new digital era.
It's probably one of the safest type of crimes. All you need is a computer, cell phone, or internet connection, and knowledge to hack a network, design a digital heist, or make an unauthorized credit card transaction.
Different kind of hacking which is going on for the long time, the people used to use the credit card numbers and the account numbers for the hacking at the website and through their transfer money in their own accounts.
Most commonly used places to commit cybercrimes are internet cafes in Pakistan, where usually no registration is required, nor proof of identity. Makes this outlet a safe haven to operate and escape the crime scene, while the culprit is sometimes practically untraceable.
Normally, we find an IP address up till the cyber cafe when we try to locate the person. And even using its proxy server information, we go to the terminal that the person was sitting here. So if it's only a 1 or 2 day old story, then the cyber cafe owner may tell us that Mr. So-and-so was sitting here. But in some of the cases, we miss the information also.
Typically, cybercrime is difficult to stop. For example, recently we were contacted for a very famous American website called PayPal, which usually is used for making transactions on the internet. And someone in Islamabad had a website which was a copy of it and was using that website to, take money from people.
Recent years have seen a rise in cyber terrorism, with more than 300 e-offense cases alone registered by the 18-month-old Cybercrime Division. The internet platform has been widely used by terrorists to project their ideology and get the message across to the world. As the trail to apprehend these groups is harder to track by conventional law enforcement agencies, especially in Pakistan, the technologically advanced cyber police makes tireless efforts to bring the perpetrators to justice. Electronic messaging, financial transactions, emails, sensitive data uploads, and or any utensil of technology used with ill intent is subject to punishment by the Cybercrime Division. And it's not just within Pakistan. With cyber policing, they can go across the border with the help of other countries.
This is one of the biggest scandals in the world in terms of its volume. Only 3 computers have been decoded. We really don't know what else we have, but we forecast that it's going to go run into dollars. And of course, the entire network worldwide, which has really alarmed the world, we have been approached by the various governments that all of a sudden they will get in one bank account $2 million or $3 million, but they won't find how and where. and who's behind it.
Though a long overdue law in Pakistan, with an ever-growing number of hackers and credit card fraud groups, the ordinance, some believe, does not safeguard or protect the innocent information technology user from the cybercrime wing, if it even has a hunch of criminal intent.
What do we mean by cybercrime? Does someone commit a crime simply because he happens to be surfacing the net? So I think a lot is yet to be done, and we would have to wait for the time to come in the future. And I think the government or the legislature will have to ensure that they can provide enough information in the act itself to ensure that the innocent are protected.
What if you have not committed the cyber crime, but just by knowing your password, your friend or someone else does it? You are the one who will be convicted if the cyber police traces the crime down to your account or computer. We can't change our password all the time. Sometimes we give it out and forget to change it. How does the law protect us in this case?
Lawmakers here have gone the extra mile to reinvent a new definition for cybercrime. Harsh punishment for cybercrime or terrorism may be the right step forward to control the warlords in cyberspace, but the ordinance has been met with skepticism by the digital savvy community, saying it has been drafted without consulting the stakeholders and does little good to the industry by flouting the Cybercrime Convention, which has been signed by 43 countries.
Pakistan has enshrined cybercrime into law, but it's vital that this law should not obstruct the freedom of information. Until this law is streamlined in Pakistan, even your free expression on the net or critical point of view on an SMS text message could land you in a lot of trouble. In Islamabad, Sip Kaifi, Press TV.